HarperOne and Harper Audio present The Rural Diaries, Love, Livestock, and Big Life Lessons Down on Mischief Farm by Hilarie Burton Morgan. This is Hilarie Burton Morgan. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/rural diaries. This contains the recipes described in this book. To my Jeffrey, you turned every daydream into a reality. I love you. And to Gus and George, I wanted you my whole life, and I'm so glad you're mine. Preface. Dear Diary, last weekend, Jeffrey and I got married. Really and truly married. It was the culmination of a decade of partnership, trial and error, and most importantly, effort. For years, we had called each other husband and wife. We lived like we were married, raised our kids as a unit, built homes and a future together. But we knew that we'd sidestepped that very real rite of passage. It was fine, livable, happy. But our life at Mischief Farm demanded better of us. We'd found a sanctuary where authenticity mattered. The truths at the farm were concrete. The fields had to be mowed, the wood had to be chopped, the gardens had to be weeded, and the animals had to be fed. We wanted to be one of those truths. So on a bright, blue-skied October afternoon, very much like the day we first laid eyes on Mischief Farm, with the kaleidoscope of hues that autumn brings, we exchanged vows in front of a colorful collection of characters from our life. We chose the Bowery Hotel, a standard haunt of ours, as we were drawn to the history and mischief of the neighborhood. The Bowery is the oldest road in New York City, from the Dutch word Bowery, meaning farm. All roads lead back to the farm. I feel strong. When we made the choice to cast off the skin of our former lives, it was with tremendous uncertainty. We barely knew each other. But this place and this life were worth the risk. They were worth the hardships we faced. They were worth every effort. Our wedding wasn't the beginning of a life together. It was a celebration and a thank you to the people and places that shaped our past 10 years. Love is like farm work. It requires consistency and imagination. Your body will ache and you will be fatigued, but there is no greater reward than seeing the fruits of your labor. In a parting gift to our guests, I included packets of Mischief Farm marigolds, seeds I'd sown from my own gardens. I hope they go out there in the world and grow and bloom and multiply with all the love from which they sprang. Hilarie Burton Morgan, 10/13/19. Prologue. What kind of farm did you grow up on? Folks always throw that question at me anytime they find out about Mischief Farm. Oh, you know, the lower middle class kind, which grows swing sets and grubby children and is surrounded by a chain link fence. My childhood was fantastically suburban. Before Mischief Farm, the only farming I had done had been through literary adventuring. Green Gables, Little House on the Prairie. I longed for the landscape of Wuthering Heights. Hell, even Animal Farm held a certain appeal. Both of my parents had agricultural experience, though. Their stories were fables in our family. My father didn't wax poetic about his childhood of manual labor. His tales were more cautionary. We never ate lamb because his family had kept sheep for a while. It scarred him. Then there were the years they dealt in chickens, equally scarring. Eggs must be scrambled to ultimate tightness, and any meat is to be cooked about 4 levels past well done. Hell or high water, we were going to be spared from any barnyard diseases. It was clear that farming was not a pleasurable career path for my father's family. Just a way to scrape by and keep 7 hungry kids fed. My mother, on the other hand, comes from real-deal farmers in Iowa. Multi-generational corn and soybean and pig farmers with huge tracts of land. The first time I visited my great-aunt's house on the farm in Iowa, I found it exotic. They had a hammock at the edge of a cornfield, and a dozen barn cats skittered around. My 3 brothers chased the cats against the backdrop of sunset, and I grabbed one of the kittens and settled into the hammock. Looking out on the cornfield, I marveled that this is what they woke up to every day. Even when I was a kid, dreaming of being a showbiz dame like Doris Day or Debbie Reynolds or Katharine Hepburn, I held on to this vision of farm life. I grew up in the little town of Sterling Park, Virginia, population 9,000. I kept the pace of the Blue Ridge Mountains. I could hear cows lowing from my high school. It was a pastoral community. And then Amazon opened a huge headquarters in Northern Virginia, right in my little town, and suddenly, an influx of 200,000 people completely erased the childhood I had grown up with. Jeffrey grew up in Kirkland, Washington. Once upon a time, it was a tiny waterfront suburb of Seattle. He camped with the Boy Scouts, rode a mean old pony named Brownie at his grandma's pig farm, and played in the woods and water of the Pacific Northwest. Then, Boeing visited, saw lots of space and a good quality of life, moved in and erased those things. So with both of our childhood communities swallowed up by big business, he and I never had the luxury of that fairy tale of raising kids in our hometowns. Randomly, we found a new hometown. Rhinebeck, New York. A place that felt like we'd known it all along. We marveled that a village like this still existed. So we were aware that when you find a community that nurtures you and your family, it isn't enough just to live in it. You must also nurture and protect that place and all the people who give you respite, solace, joy, and just enough hell to keep life interesting. So, folks, this is a love letter to a town, to a farm, to a man. Part 1, Plant. Chapter 1. Don't judge each day by the harvest you reap, but by the seeds that you plant. Robert Louis Stevenson. The first time we drove into Rhinebeck, I knew I'd found a place I belonged. As we crossed the Kingston Bridge, the world cracked open before us, all sun and sky and river. A large billboard for the Dutchess County Fair promised livestock and carnival rides and country music acts. A driftwood sculpture that loosely resembled a dinosaur peeped out behind a few trees as we approached the town. I scratched the hair at the base of Jeffrey's skull and I kept my hand on his neck. It felt bold. Together, fewer than 2 years, we hadn't exactly been in a honeymoon phase. Parenting was hard. Being apart for work was hard. Not having a real place to call home was hard. But riding along side by side, we felt light and hopeful and new. Our 5-month-old son, Gus, babbled in his car seat. This felt like a place where things were made, a place that invited possibility. We rolled through Rhinebeck Village, a tiny Dutch community that reminded me of Pella, Iowa, where my mom's family was from. Skinny buildings stacked up against each other that housed long-established mom-and-pop shops, where you went just as much for the camaraderie as for any material goods. Rhinebeck only has 2 commercial streets, Route 9 or Mill Street, which has a couple churches, a post office, and a bank, and Market Street. On the corner stands a handsome brick building with a sign that reads, Rhinebeck Department Store. At the crossroads is the Beekman Arms, a stately white inn with black trim and American flags snapping in the breeze. It's the oldest operating inn in the country. George Washington and other revolutionaries stayed there, and the 4th Regiment of the Continental Army practiced drills on its lawn. We parked and asked a couple people where to get a cup of coffee, and they directed us to the candy store on Market Street. We passed one cute painted storefront after another, noticing how the sidewalk was hemmed in by a tidy line of trees whose trunks were surrounded by bursts of colorful flowers. Small crowds of smiling people moved along to a seemingly well-rehearsed choreography. Nod, smile, wave at the baby, tip the hat, smile again. Like out of an old musical, the town had a rhythm that made it feel like someone might burst into song at any moment. At the end of the block, we stepped inside the candy store, a tiny jewel box of a shop, cool and dark and soothing. The shelves were lined with luminescent rows of penny candy. I spotted cowtails, which I hadn't eaten since I was 12. A flushed, smiling gentleman with a bush of curly hair chatted easily as he rang us up. "Welcome to town. What brings you guys here?" "Oh, we're looking at a house," Jeff replied. The man was incandescent. "You guys are gonna love it here. You're just gonna love it. I moved up from the city, too." We smiled and thanked him for the coffee, and Jeff patted my rear on the way out the door. He gets handsy when he's excited, though I didn't quite know how yet. I sensed our lives were about to change. Of all the twists and turns a life takes, driving into Rhinebeck was one of the few turns when I felt truly home. But to make sense of how we got here, I have to back up for a moment and point out the seeds of change that led me here. Seed 1, loss. The trajectory of my life changed in 2007. At the time, I was working on One Tree Hill and feeling a bit lost. I worked hard all day, and then I went out and sang karaoke in the bars with my friends until closing, then got up early the next day and worked again. And while I was smiling and perfecting my rendition of Dolly Parton's Applejack, I was a miserable girl. My whole life had been an ambitious climb to become a working actor, and I'd done it. So why was I so damn disappointed? In August, we were shooting a scene down by Cape Fear River. It was one of those big days with every actor in every scene and 100 extras. Overwhelmed, I retreated to the air conditioning of my trailer and scrolled through MySpace alerts on my phone. A buddy from high school, Stan, popped up in my messages. I don't remember the exact message, but I have a vague recollection of his trying to gently break the news to me. "Hilarie, I know it's been a long time. I'm not sure if anyone else has reached out. I know you guys were close." And then he said it. Scott Kirkpatrick had died in Iraq. My heart skittered in my chest. In high school, Scott and Stan had been part of the cool drama goth poetry slam circle that I idolized. Scott was 2 years older than me, and I wanted to do everything just like him, including writing and acting. Scott and his friends would pick me up after the football games I cheered at, and we'd drive to Clyde's in Reston, where we'd order a bucket of sweet potato fries and they'd smoke clove cigarettes. We worked on our tortured poems and go to poetry slams together, me in my cheerleading uniform, and them in their big dark trench coats and little Dracula glasses. Scott was the kind of person who made you feel like big, magical things were right around the corner, and you just had to be bold enough to make the turn. We all followed dutifully. After graduation, Scott, with his Kurt Cobain hair and lanky gait, became a nationally ranked slam poet and traveled all over the country. And then, after September 11th, he joined the Army. When I heard the news, I was shocked. Scott deployed to Iraq and became a sergeant, and then got married and was planning to leave the Army and come home to his wife. He and I kept in touch via MySpace, where he gave me hell for being on the cover of Maxim with all the girls from One Tree Hill. "What the fuck's going on, Burton? That's not the girl I know." We'd made plans to return to our theater roots and make indie movies together once he got out of the service. The big plan was to do an update of a play we'd done in high school, Dostoevsky's The Idiot. I'd begun mapping the story out, filling a spiral notebook with ideas and research. He was almost done with his tour when somebody shot one of the guys in his squad. Scott and another soldier chased the attacker into a building that had been rigged to explode. This was a cheat I couldn't stand for. Not Scott. My life took a turn, and I struggled with the grief and unfairness of losing him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.